Zule Mast. Damit ja herab.
I'm very happy to be with you today and to be in Tallinn. Switzerland and Estonia share something in common. We both are small countries. And we both learned to have a wide horizon with our minds, to go abroad and to learn new things. And both countries actually have very low unemployment rate. So one difference, of course, we have mountains and you have the sea instead. So I'm happy to share with you a little bit the global perspective of interim management. As you know, this is my agenda. Who is Brainforce? Why interim management? Where it's typically applied? The resources pool, some short case studies in various markets, and something which I added here about intercultural issues at the example of China and Europe. So just to give you a little bit the sensitivity about the cultural issues, which is very important in interim management. So Brainforce was established in 1979. I was not the founder. Actually, the founder was looking for his succession when he was 79 years old. He hired me to be his successor and finally to take over the company, which finally happened. So I run the company now for the last 14 years and own it for the last 11 years. At that time, when Brainforce was established in 1979, there was no word such as interim management. It did not exist. There was no interim managers, and there were no customers who believed that interim management could be a value. So, with just an idea, a concept, the company started. Initially, the company started with actually some retired executives who were 65 plus. 65 is the retirement age in Switzerland. And so basically utilized those freshly retired executives. On the customer side, customers were suspicious because Switzerland is a country mainly based on SMEs. Don't think just about the Nestlés and the ABBs and so on. They are also in Switzerland, but actually the majority of the economy is based on mid-sized, small and mid-sized companies, a lot of privately held companies. So it was actually quite difficult to develop that market. So it took many years initially to get it growing. But end of 1980s, it's really started to pick up. And another boost came in 1990s. And we, as Brainforce, expanded also to Germany at that time. We were the first 20 years alone in the market. There was no other agency in interim management. And but it was also very hard because there were not so many customers asking for this kind of service. But then it started to pick off. Some of the competitors today were former employees of Brainforce who basically someday thought, okay, we make open our own company and utilize the knowledge what they learned with Brainforce and apply it. And after 2000, let's say the last 20 years plus minus, the whole market in continental Europe in interim management just have mushroomed. Today it's a multi-billion euro market, quite sizable. So we have also internationalized because the world gets more and more global. It's clear that interim management is not just a Swiss issue, a Switzerland issue, or Germany issues. It's actually something which can be applied in all markets. So we started to expand. We have today 10 own offices and 2 associate companies. And we do every year about 70 to 150 assignments from the middle to top management level. Since our inception, we did more than 4,000 mandates. And the range where we work is from SMEs to large companies. It can be a multinational company, but actually the share of interim management aids for multinational companies is very small, because a very huge company, they always find a way to shift somebody around. And what I learned myself, I worked also more than 10 years in multinational companies. A multinational company, a huge company, they can afford to be inefficient in when it comes to certain details. Whether a project, you know, $500,000 or $1 million is lost, okay, there are some red hats in a meeting, but finally not much happened. If an SME, a private held company, loses $500,000 or $1 million, that can decide whether the company survives or not. So this is the difference. That's why interim management is especially geared towards, let's say, small, mid-sized and large SMEs companies. These are our offices. We focus on, initially, of course, on Europe, on Eastern Europe, Russia. Then we expanded to Asia, especially China, because most European companies started to do business with China, the huge Chinese market, and Southeast Asia, which we serve out of Bangkok. We added actually some companies. Just Lisbon is, as of last week, is very new. It's our new associate company, where we actually manage the whole pool management process. And but it's one of our pool members who actually became CEO of that company in Lisbon, and with access to more than 1,000 executives, we actually have here access to the Portuguese-speaking market, which not only is Portugal, but also Brazil, Mozambique, Angola, countries which are markets of several hundred million inhabitants in total, and we occasionally do actually have some inquiries related to these markets. In our pool, we have, as of officially communicated, as of January 2019, we so far have communicated about 5,000, but in the meantime, in the last years, we have increased our pool, and we will officially utilize the 6,500 as of next year. The average age of the pool members, as we call them, is around 52. So age range between, let's say, 45 to 60. This is most of our pool members, interim managers, in the pool. When we analyze what country experiences they have, more than 30 countries experience, 20 languages we will find in this pool, and all of them, they have 10, 20, 30 plus years of experience as a manager or leader on all continents, in fact. So it does not mean that when we have no office in the United States, that we don't do mandates in US. In fact, I will show you a case study which we did last year in the US, also in interim management. Just a few words about interim management as such. For me, it's clear interim management is the approach in the 21st century, where the economy gets more and more quick. Flex need to be flexible, need to try new things, need to have the know-how right away, not wait for months and develop that know-how in-house. So you basically take now what you need on demand. So an interim manager is immediately available through a provider who has a pool. He is neutral, objective. He has not a biased view when he enters a company and takes over an operational responsibility. The provider ensures that it's a perfect fit. And customers have become very demanding, especially in mature markets like Switzerland or Germany. On a scale from 1 to 10, the fit of that particular situation may be 10 years ago, you know, with a 6 out of 10, you were still okay. Customer probably would have hired you, or hired that taken that candidate. But today, if it's not an 8 or 9 of the scale of 10, we will not get the mandate. So customers have become very demanding. The defined time period is a big advantage. You know, it's very well can be quantified, and it's very results driven. We talked before at the panel a bit, you know, to what extent there are clear goals and objectives. There are always goals and objectives, but sometimes it is maybe more qualitatively, and sometimes it can be very quantitatively. This is clear, and it depends on the nature of the task and the responsibility. There is one word which is missing here, but I think you will tell me what that word could be. What does actually fundamentally get the customer get from an interim manager? Why is it of such a value to a customer? And I would like to ask you in the audience about this keyword. Maybe just competencies? Outside view?
Solutions, ideas.
New knowledge? Change? Flexibility?
Solutions and ideas.
Solutions, ideas? It's all very true, absolutely. I'm still for looking for one word. Results is there. Freedom. Well, the customer, yeah, I mean, he has more flexibility, yes, of course, with an interim manager. But fundamentally, what does an interim manager actually bring in? He can be is efficient when you truly calculate. I mean, the customer will say, oh, how expensive interim management, you know. But when you look, when you make the calculation, at the end of the day, it's the best solution. It's the cheapest solution. And I always tell clients, you know, the cheapest solution the customer thinks of finally, not taking an interim manager, because sometimes he think to promote somebody from internal may be the cheapest solution, but it turns out to be the most expensive one at the end of the day. We have seen so many cases. But maybe I help you a bit. And actually, it's the word experience. Experience is the fundamental word here. And this word experience, I just want to briefly show you something. Why interim management is so interesting for a customer. This is time, and this is, let's say, experience, huh? Whatever you do when you start a project and you start something new, you have a learning curve, right? A learning curve, and this learning curve typically has such a behavior. You know, you start and then you gain knowledge, experience, and then the differential gain in knowledge over time flattens when it becomes routine. So, when an interim manager is called, it's usually a new situation, a special situation, and the customer has a choice of building up that know-how, that what is needed for this, or he gets an interim manager who is already coming in with an experience of this subject, which he has done already before. So actually he starts not here, he starts already here. And he also will learn something, of course, but at the end of the day, when you look at what the value of the interim manager is this area. It's the learning curve. The learning curve for everything what you do in a new project, the learning curve is actually very expensive. It takes time. Time is money. When you do it the first time, you make mistakes. This is all costly, and this is all hidden cost in a company. When you bring in an interim manager who has done this job several times before, he will make less mistakes, and actually he will be much faster there where the customer wants to be. Has the solution done before, earlier, or at much more efficiently. So this value here is what actually an interim manager really brings in for a client, for any type of project he takes over. So it's wonderful, you know, to have a concept of interim management where you as a customer, I mean, those of you who are potential clients or who run a company, you know, to, when something happens and you can expect within 1 or 2 weeks from the first telephone call, the whole process through even a choice of several candidates to all the contractual things, to have the perfect guy on board to take over the responsibility, who stays there, for example, 9 months, a very typical average duration of an interim management aid, and somebody who has more than 20 years experience. We have so many cases where the customer said, well, you know, how is that possible? We were looking for half a year on the market for this kind of skill and experience. We did not find it. And you come and you bring us within 4 days candidates, and which can start next week. You know, so this is something which is very amazing, and those customers who have utilized interim management, they come again. 70-80% of our business actually is repeat business, repeat customers, or are through recommendation. It just shows that those companies who have worked with interim management, they use it again. They know what the value is. Where is it typically applied? Is it just bridging management gaps, or is it more? Of course it's more. But traditionally, and even today, you have classic cases of bridging a management gap. An example is you have an HR director who is on maternity leave. So this HR director will leave for delivering the baby and come back several months later. Can be years, but normally, you know, in many cases we see, we have several cases like that. Usually these women are very power women, and they come back usually after a few months, 3-4 months, and then they are back on track. I mean, we have also the usually three, 4 months, but actually most of the time these women want to come back. They don't want to stay home too long, but they want to come back to work. And so this is a gap. You cannot replace the internal HR director with somebody from the team. That is just a non-go. You cannot take on somebody, you know, from the team and say, now you're the HR director for the next few months, and then when when the person comes back, go down again to that team position. Because of all confidentiality and all these kind of things, that's a non-go. So the only way, efficient way, is really to get an interim HR director who will come for the defined period of time and goes when the postholder comes back. Another gap is finance director has, CFO has quit his job because he changed his company, he goes to another company, and maybe his contract term is finishing end of the year, and the company of course has started the search on the market for a succession. Candidates were identified, guys were selected, the person they liked even contracted, but finally that person didn't sign up, decided not to take the offer. So that's a big problem for a company, because you are end of the year, financial closing comes up, no CFO, the existing CEO is just leaving, you know, a few days before Christmas because it's his last day. And early December, still no succession. This happens. It's not just hypothetical. We often have such cases. And the search has to be redone. Takes, of course, a few months till somebody comes. But they need, before Christmas, a CFO, an interim CFO. So we can deliver that. And this person will take over, few days overlap with the outgoing CFO, and then do the annual closing and hand over 6 months later to the newly hired permanent CFO. But this is classic bridging management gaps. But actually, as I said, it's a lot more. For example, moving factories, moving production lines from Europe to India, to China, to Singapore, in different industries. We have done that in for textile machinery company, for machine tool company, solar panel manufacturing company, medtech company. This is a trend which you always see. Yes, there are some relocations because of for cost reasons, but also market driven. Because if you have products which are now more and more used, bought, purchased in a huge market like China, then of course it makes a lot more sense to have a local manufacturing in China and not ship everything out of Europe there, out from Europe there. Oops. Another project can be in procurement, purchasing, you know, buying the product a company buys for production raw materials, semi-finished materials, components, and so on. A project can be, for example, you know, to reduce procurement costs. The company says, you know, we have a problem, we have too high costs, we need to reduce them by 10, 20, 30%. Do you have an experienced procurement manager who comes in and looks at what we have done and has some new ideas how we could maybe renegotiate or find new ways to reduce the cost? And these are real cases which I just simplified here, but we have been able to do that. Another nice case was in Russia for a Swiss privately held group in building materials or industrial components and systems, but it's used in various areas industrial, but also in construction. And the company was there for 7 years in Russia, was loss-making every year, 7 years in a row. And the owner and CEO said, now it's finished. So either we close down Russia, or we put in, we try an interim management role to turn around this company. So they hired a Russian interim manager from us. He was there for 18 months. And he was able to turn it around. The company turned from black from red into black. And this mandate was finished about 4 or 5 years ago. And the company still today is profitable. So even after, and it shows that an interim manager is not just coming there to fix something on short term, because he's there to fix a problem, but fundamentally. And he cleaned up the company. There were some compliance issues, there were some corruption issues, there were a lot of things typically happening in such kind of operations. So he cleaned it up fundamentally, and he made it ready for a less senior interim manager who took over after that the managing director role. And this successor, permanent successor, for him it was a lot easier to continue. It was just a different base. So our interim manager was able to set a new starting point for the company. Another nice case was in Croatia. This was a factory with 850 people. And what you see here is an award ceremony where the interim manager receives a medal. It's the Croatian Kuna from the Minister for Industry at that time. And this Croatian Kuna is awarded to the best leaders, business leaders in the country. And our person there was just an interim manager. So, and he got this award. So it just shows that a strong interim manager with a lot of experience can really do a lot. This was a loss-making, near insolvency company, and it became really a showcase for the Croatian government, for foreign investors. There was a lot of problems, alcohol problems, all these things, and our interim manager had to let go about 40% of the whole factory staff, but it was necessary. It was a bloodbath initially. He was the most hated person in the city. He had to move hotels every few days, and he got nasty phone calls. And but he had, you know, he was a silverback. He didn't care too much about it. And when he left after 3 years, this was extended. The client was very happy, and he said, "Well, you should stay on." He became the even country manager. And after 3 years, you know, there was a letter from the mayor of Karlovac, that city, this was actually Alstom Group, and to the corporate group CEO, a two-page letter, why this managing director is now leaving, because he did so much great things for the local economy there and turn around this company. Why he would not stay on? The company should keep him there. So it just shows, you know, how big the impact was. Another nice project, an application of interim management, is know-how. This is a small company which is actually specialized in ultra-secure communication devices for military, for embassies, for all these kind of things. There are only a few companies in the world which actually are so specialized in this. And the company had table devices, size devices at that time, and they had a military customer who said, "Okay, I would like this functionality, but in a handheld device, in 12 months, 500 units delivered, and this company, our client, will achieve it, then you get 2,500 more units ordered." So the small company had a problem because they were not used to the miniaturization process. So they could build this larger equipment, but not handheld devices. So they said either to decline the contract or to take the risk and actually hire an interim manager who would actually lead this process. So they got an interim manager which was in encryption technology, who knew the European market technology-wise extremely well, who has done such kind of miniaturization projects. So basically, he was that guy who proposed and negotiated contracts with some technology partner in Europe. So they did the co-development, this client with that technology partner, and then produced the prototype, made a first small series for field testing, and finally made the 500 units. The 500 units were delivered on time, 12 months later, you know. So, and the owner, CEO of that company, of that client, he was extremely happy, and he never forgot that. We are still friends today, and he's even in our advisory board. So it just shows, you know, that what you can impact with somebody with the right fit, with the right know-how, the right experience, immediately and for a given period of time. Another very nice project is when you fly Lufthansa Group airlines, like Swiss, Lufthansa, Austrian Airlines, but also about 6-7 other airlines, you sit in the business class, you sit on air cushion. You may not know that, but this is a fundamental change and an alternative to foam. Most aircraft seats are foam. This is actually air as a pneumatic system. And this was invented by a Swiss company. And this Swiss company actually is world market leader for the fabrics. So most airlines in the world, 70% world market share, fabrics are from that company in Switzerland. It's amazing, it's true. And because of the special requirements for aircrafts. Anyway, the company had developed a prototype of this pneumatic system. But this was a textile company. And now we talk about a pneumatic system with plastic, you know, and things like that. A very different business. The know-how, definitely not in-house. So they had, with external help, developed this prototype and now had the problem to industrialize that. The whole supply chain, to find a manufacturer to produce these pneumatic systems. So they hired an interim manager who was specialized in these industrialization processes from plastics field. And he was there for actually 2.5 years, part-time, and until the first aircrafts were equipped. Swiss was the first airline in the world who actually introduced that system, and then it actually spread out to other airlines. So the master pool, as we call our pool, is it a toolbox? Yes, it's in a toolbox, true. Maybe not as old-fashioned as it may see here. We have also very, very up-to-date, sharp guys who are very up-to-date in know-how. But the principle is the same. You know, we have a pool, and this is for all providers like VVT, the same, a pool of experts, of people in different areas, fields, positions. And the provider, VVT or Brainforce, we actually understand the customer's needs, what he needs now, next week, and then we check who actually in this pool fits perfectly to that situation with the right know-how, the right experience. And then when it's done, the project, the solution is there, the interim manager comes back to the pool and does something else. The important thing is the selection for the pool. You cannot take everybody into the pool. I think it's you can imagine, first of all, the provider opposite the client needs to ensure that all the people he proposes are strong people and will deliver, will get to the result. And this means that you cannot have lame ducks in a pool. You have to have strong interim managers who really are where you know these are the absolute strengths of these guys. And so that's a selection process which is very crucial for that business. Typically, I'm just using here our own pool for statistical purposes to show a little bit what kind of functions. This is a split by function. You can see that almost one-third of the people are channel management, like all the Cs, the CEOs, the CFOs, the CSOs, the CROs, the CMOs, you know, whatever, that level. But then we have all the other key functions a normal company has. HR, production, quality, R&D, logistics, supply chain, IT, finance, marketing, sales. So with such a split, of course, you can, on a very short notice, with a large pool, give a client within 2 or 3 days, 2 or 3 candidates who can start next week, if the pool has the right size. By industry, also traditionally it has shown that interim management is particularly useful for companies who produce something. Automotive, machinery, electronics, plastic injection molding parts. Everywhere where time is money, where quality is important, consistency, but and processes are important, and you cannot afford to make mistakes, and things need to be quick. So that's why the classic manufacturing sector has clearly been the leader in demand for interim management. Most mandates are somewhere related in the German-speaking area, at least, in this area, in this field. In China also, I mean, practically all of our mandates are for industrial manufacturing companies, all kinds. But then we have all the other sectors, of course, financial service, banks, insurance. Then you have telecom, you have some construction industry, consumer goods trade, and even some government. In Germany, not Germany. Germany is very strict, no interim management in governmental entities. In Switzerland, we are more liberal on this. And when you look at markets like Holland or England, actually there is a lot of interim management done in the public sector. A few case studies. Here a case study of an automotive supplier, a German company, privately held. They had about a dozen factories globally. One of them was acquired with 450 people in China. So when they acquired this company, they had financial closing coming up. And then they asked themselves the question, how can we actually manage this company? Because in Germany, we have nobody who has China experience. And and the existing personnel or the management from the selling party is maybe, well, we have someone from, this is the person who sold the company to this company, is the CEO. But they had also some question marks whether this is a good idea. Finance was a disaster. There was a department there of people, but nobody really knew what they do and if the numbers are right. And in China, a privately held company, you know, they do creative accounting very much and very simple. So that's not German level accounting. So what happened was, they said, well, the first thing what we need after financial closing is to have a CFO, an independent, neutral, objective CFO who comes in, makes a post due diligence, looks at there's maybe some dead bodies in the basement, right, which has not been found before. So anyway, 1 year, clean up, make everything to German standard in terms of finance. So it was a Chinese lady who had previously done similar things for other German companies. Very strong lady, power woman. She was there. She had quite some initial problems with because she was detecting a lot of things. So she got some hints, nasty hints. And but anyway, so she cleaned it up. And finally, the customer also extended the contract because she was just very good. And so now the mandate is finished, but anyway, so the finance part was done. The GM was then the next one because I just mentioned this former owner who became employed CEO of the new company, and this and the interest of this person working hard actually was disappearing. And our customer, and said, well, you know, I think we really have to make a change now. And so we had put in an interim CEO, managing director, to run the company. And that person was there for 1 year. And then that person became permanent. So the customer asked if they could keep this interim manager for good, which happened. And last but not least, for the same company, the company started to be profitable, started to expand, and they said, well, actually we could out of China develop the Asian markets, Korea, Japan, things like that. And they said, okay, we have no person at the moment in China who has experience for that. Do you have an interim manager for this? Which happened, and this person, same thing happened, the person there for 2 years, interim, and is now permanent, has joined the company permanently for that position. Another example, a specialty chemicals company, is an SME, a small company in fact from Germany, privately held also, and they have three employees in Thailand, but actually, you know, they have no legal entity, so they only sell there. And but if since they don't have a legal entity, they cannot just do that like this, and it's not efficient to do it everything out of Europe. So basically what they did is to hire from us two technical guys who actually do all over Asia, out of Bangkok, technical services for clients who buy these specialty chemicals to make sure that what they buy, the customer, the end customer, is really applying it properly and the quality is there, and they buy more of this product. And also One Sales Asia, this is as a kind of developed over time. So this was a very good model where actually for the customer, the producer, he's very happy with the solution and he doesn't need to set up a legal entity because he uses our legal entity for these kind of services. Then a very nice case in South Africa is a restructuring case. Two factories, more than 1,000 people, a total disaster, belonged to an international group from Europe, some material construction, or let's say some, yeah, it's building materials. They had strikes, they had no cash, they had price fixing, court cases, so it was pretty much a disaster. And we got the call on a Friday and said, you know, our head of Africa is visiting next Wednesday, Johannesburg. Can you present to us three candidates for the managing director for this case? So that's what we did. They looked at the three candidates and decided for one, and the guy started the following week. Was there for 1 year. Everything was pretty much back on track, and the client took him over as permanent CEO in this case. But one thing I would like to mention, why, because normally an interim manager does not want to go into permanent, normally. It's in Europe very rare, in Germany, Switzerland, less than 5% of the cases. In cases like this, actually it's always special situations why an interim manager does that. Because in the South Africa case, actually there was an expansion plan to go to other sub-Saharan countries, you know, Tanzania, Kenya, or Angola, all these countries, and actually he brought in this experience. So actually, after cleaning up South Africa, there was a lot of new projects for him, exciting things to expand the company into the region. So for this purpose, for this situation, he felt, yeah, that's interesting. So I go for permanent. Whether this permanent will last for 10 years is another question, but you know, if he stays another 2 or 3 years, it's okay. And for him, it's interesting. Otherwise, most interim managers would get bored after 2 years, 3 years doing the same thing. Another case in the US, digital health sector. The company had 500 employees in USA. It's basically a company who does not produce physical materials, but they make software development and they do sales. And all the products, the physical products, are produced by other companies, third party, and but their core competency is software and selling this, systems and services associated with it. So they had a bit of turmoil in the sales organization, declining market share. It was also the case that the products they had were a bit at the end of the lifetime. So competition became stronger and declining market share. The CEO decided to put in an interim vice president for marketing and sales because marketing was also a problem. They were fighting, the sales guys and the marketing people fighting each other, claiming, blaming each other. And so basically putting a strong senior guy who actually had very similar experience in terms of products, what they sold here. So he knew the industry extremely well. And he came there and he, you know, started to organize on one side the marketing department better, made some changes in the team leadership. He took the sales guys much, he really managed and led these sales guys. Before they were kind of like loose electrons all over USA. And so now he really started to put in processes, and these guys had to report, and he supported them also, of course. He visited some customers with them, some key customers, and basically gave a boost. So this was a 6-month project, and even after 6 months, because they hired then finally a permanent one, but in this case, it was an immediate action to improve the situation. And actually, within 6 months, there was a clear change in the trend. Instead of declining market share, they could already see that now new orders coming in. So it was all about leadership in this case. And that's actually very common in most interim management mandates. It's the leadership issue. Getting the people really on board and working together. It's not a miracle, you know, just a know-how or something like this. This is part of it, but at the end of the day, it's leadership. Some intercultural issues. For me, it's, I like this topic very much because when you work cross-border, you have automatically to deal with this subject. You know, you have a European company with its style, either privately held, patronal style operation, or even a multinational company which has an operation in Germany or Switzerland and has an operation in China in a certain division, certain product division. But, you know, it's maybe the same company, but the culture and how things operate is quite different, or can be very different. So I just try to compare a bit stereotype, but and I would like to discuss with you a bit whether you have different opinions, but I try to compare a bit on a few slides here, 2 slides about decision making. What is different in a classic Chinese management approach and a Western European management approach? I mean, we, in the German-speaking part of Europe at least, we decide usually on fact and figures. We consider all scenarios before committing. We review risks carefully before deciding or delivering commitment. We don't overpromise. We usually maybe underpromise and overdeliver. We don't sign just a contract out of without really understanding the risks. So that sometimes makes the process maybe a bit slow, but also we don't tend to make big risks. I mean, that's what my general simplified picture is. I don't know how it is in Estonia. How you would say, would you say in Estonia is similar or is it a different cultural behavior? Rather different. Okay. How would you see a decision making instead of what is in common, let's say, Switzerland, Germany, Austria? What would you see different? More to China. Okay, interesting. Okay, good. All right. So China, we come to China. So it's trial and error based on persons, personal judgment and experience. Catch the chance first and find solution later. We often see this situation, you know, that there are some Chinese companies offering things which they know they cannot do it now. They just want to get the contract first. And then when they have the contract, they look for a solution. Then they look for subcontractors who then finally get them the know-how.
I hope the trial. I hope this trial and error is not very common in Estonia, but catch the chance first and the solution later is very common.
Okay. Okay. You see, even in Europe we have differences. I mean, we have even differences between.
We are always comparing us, maybe to our neighbors or our business partners, and comparing with Sweden and Finland. Mm-hmm. We are really most risk-taking and close. Close to this China part,
okay.
I think.
Very interesting input, yeah.
But comparing with Lithuanians, I think that we are more commitment based. Mm-hmm. So it's depend where we are taking your comparisons.
Yeah. Okay. Exactly. It depends. That's very true. It's and each market, each culture has some special behaviors, and you need to be aware of that when you deal with that particular country or market, or when you put an interim manager for such a situation, because he need to bridge the cultures. He need to be compatible to the local market, and he need to be compatible to our client in the other market. So he need to build that bridge. So another, let's say, in the German-speaking part, focus on details within the bigger picture, very typical. We look at more midterm life cycle cost considerations. We assume responsibility for the consequence. And people, when they do something, they really, you know, feel responsible for it. And even if it goes wrong, they don't hide or disappear, but actually they take the blame. And setting priorities and do one after another. This is kind of a bit generalized common behavior for, let's say, German-speaking companies or culture, management culture. In China, Chinese very much focus on the mainline only. They very much look as companies, not as state-owned enterprises or government. They are very long-term. But when we talk about privately companies, which are really business-driven, they look very short-term. Normally, first cost consideration, as an example, you know, when you have developers building apartments or office buildings, so they build as cheap as possible because, you know, the maintenance after is paid by those who bought the condominiums, and that's not the developer's problem, right? So that's then the problem of those guys who bought the condominium. And so therefore, he builds as cheap as possible, sells it as high as possible in price, and the rest for the future is up to the buyer. Then Chinese often don't decide when they are, or let's say when they when they feel it could go wrong and it's not the expected result, they're very reluctant to decide. This has a face-saving thing in the Chinese culture, so when you see deal with Chinese and they don't want to decide, it means they see some risks for themselves. Priority set by the day's needs, firefighting, very typical. Chinese companies, very hierarchical. Everything is on the table of the CEO or of the owner. And there is a fire today. He deals with the fire, but actually tomorrow, before the first fire is extinct, tomorrow even a bigger fire somewhere else. So he jumps to the bigger fire. The old fire is still there, but he cannot deal with it anymore, you know. So it's a very typical behavior. And we see that also, we deal with some Chinese customers as well, and it's very typical, very typical. You know, very urgent thing today, tomorrow maybe not urgent. Actually, the problem is still there, but he has even more urgent things to deal with. Have a kind of a cooperative approach based on, or let's say we cooperate on process, procedures, and rules. Compliance generally comes first. The result comes through the process. And we find the solution based on procedure and root cause analysis. We try to find out why is this quality problem You know, what is the root cause of it? And then when we have identified the problem, then we try to prevent the problem for the future. In a Chinese environment, it's the cooperation is mainly based on trusting each other, even if the competence is not there. And there is a lot of unwritten rules. So you will often find in Chinese companies no job description, zero. People know who is doing what, but you know, on what is maybe on an official chart is maybe not reflecting the truth. So there are some people who are maybe relatives of the owner somewhere down in the organization. They are more important than their superior. You know, so there is a lot of unclear things which, as an outsider, is very difficult to catch. Then Chinese very, very result-oriented, actually quite pragmatic often, and the result, to get to the result, whatever it takes, is acceptable. Anything. Then they prefer also to find solution for quickly fixing the problem now. So this very, the Chinese are very good in fixing a problem for now and to get it going somehow. So they are very creative in this, for quick fixes, if you want to say. Anything different in an Estonian environment? Or where would you see yourself here as Estonians in these two pictures? Silence, okay. Let's go to the next final slide. We have clearly defined responsibilities and reporting lines typically. We tell subordinates what is expected as a result. And usually European or Swiss companies tend to have a flat hierarchy, cooperative, which actually an approach which enhances innovation and a sense of duty. As soon as if you, in contrast to Chinese environment where you have a very strong hierarchy, it actually inhibits a bit innovation. And it's this less sense of duty. People only do what they are told to do. Don't dare to do something else. And so basically in China, very typical, you need to tell the subordinates what and how to do very often. How to do, because you know, as in as opposite to European apprenticeship or these kind of dual education systems, China doesn't have that. Either it's unskilled or it's academic. There is not much in between. So the rest, that means that you have to train to develop the people who work in the factory from scratch and tell them exactly what to and how to do things. And it's very, what I mentioned before, also very unclear responsibilities and reporting line. So it's, everything is a bit vague. So we had our 30 years anniversary in 2009. We have our 40 years anniversary next year. So this was our celebration we had almost 10 years ago. But so here I'm at the end of my presentation. I hope I have given you a little bit a picture about the wide world in interim management, and I'm very happy to have one or the other question for final Q&A. Any question from your side?
While they are thinking, I have the financial background, so. Your brain force, I'm your, from your 6,500, the list of the persons. There's a company. With whom should I make the agreement?
It's always brain force. We are, as a provider, a contract party to the final customer, always.
Okay.
Yeah.
And with me, what kind of contract you will have?
We have an internal contract. We have an internal contract.
I shall be a worker, or do I have my own company? Or
can be both.
Both.
Can be both, yes. Depending, actually, the trend of the interim managers in Germany, Switzerland has completely changed the last 10 years. 10 years ago, let's say 90% were, let's say, like employed through our company and deployed then seconded it to a company, and today 90% is actually they have their own company, limited or, you know, let's say from a social security point of view, are a company, and we have a B2B relationship. So on both sides, this is a trend clearly.
Selge, OÜ-tamine on seal ka vahes. Aga nüüd küsimused teie poolt on veel. Ma siit ei näe, ausalt öelda.
I just generalize what my neighbor asked also. So, what do 6,000 people are doing continuously?
I think it's very it's a very good question, because, you know, the business model to have on a short notice the perfect match requires a big pool. With a small pool, you cannot do that. So that means the model, as I described it here, is very much geared towards clients, because a client can get extremely quick a perfect match, even to choose from two or three candidates. So that requires a big pool. On the other hand, if you look at the pool members themselves, of course, you know, statistically, they will not get many calls from us. This is clear. But having said that, interim managers, they acquire also mandates themselves. And actually, the majority of the mandates, as the statistics shows, that the majority of the mandates is acquired by the interim managers themselves, about 60% statistically in Germany, Switzerland. So 60-65% is acquired themselves, and the rest is through providers. Having said that, there is still kind of a bit of difference in terms of, let's say, the most interesting mandates, usually only through providers, because the companies, for them, for high, really high level, very important positions, it's too risky for them just to take a single person from the market, unless they know the person, you know? So there is some kind of experience with them before. They may do that. But for a lot of other jobs which are maybe less, you know, high impact mandates, they will probably get these kind of projects directly. But again, you know, the trend is going back a little bit to providers. The reason is legal issues, labor issues, because tax issues, because tax authorities have become very tough in the Germany, Switzerland, Austria in the meantime, that if someone is declaring himself, even with a small company, as an interim manager and goes directly to work with a company, that he works there maybe for 9 months, 1 year, and at the next audit by the tax authorities, social security tax authorities, after years, they may say, wait a minute, there was 1 year somebody here. Well, it looked, I mean, you declare it as a B2B business deal, but actually this is fake employment. You bypass the social security system somehow, and they will ask the employer or the company who hired this guy to pay social security after years. This has happened quite a few times, and that's why it has become an issue. In Germany and Switzerland, Austria, it is a big issue. And so now more and more companies say, you know, we don't directly contract with an interim manager, even if he has this one-man company, but for this risk we don't want to take. Through a third party, like a provider entity, this risk is minimized. So all the court cases have shown that the model works clearly better with a provider in between. Thank you very much for listening.